Thank you very much, Jimmy. Okay, we are going to talk about Egypt now. From bankers to Egypt, the massive news story this evening. President Mubarak not going. Not yet, anyway. He made a speech earlier this evening.
He made a massive, there was a massive build-up announcement. 8 o'clock, he's making a speech. Yeah. And then he went, I'm going to stay till September.
You see,
he's misread this situation. So this is the worst misreading of a situation since John Lennon said that's not a real gun.
That's how you do a speech. That's, you know, you don't tell people what's in this country. Every time a politician makes a speech, the entire contents of the speech has been in the paper the day before. This time, we were actually wondering. So you
admire the surprise?
I admire the surprise. Doesn't mean I admire everything about him.
So what's happening now in the square?
In Tahrir Square. Well, the protesters are really angry, obviously, and they're not going anywhere. I mean, everybody's kind of saying, you know, they're staying, and the protests going to go on, and I guess we'll see what happens tomorrow.
Trouble with this whole thing is if there is a revolution in Egypt and a democracy starts there, they're not. When that happened in 1989 across Europe, all of those countries were immediately friends with the West because we'd always been massively against the previous regimes there. In this case, we've done loads of business with the regimes they've overthrown. We've basically bolstered them, and so they're not going to be our friends, and we've got absolutely no way of securing good diplomatic relations with these countries.
I mean, one of the worries...
Cheery thought.
One of the other worries about it is that Mubarak is going to hand over power to the vice president, who's head of the secret police, apparently. That doesn't sound good. I mean, you know, if he kind of ends up doing that, I think he said that reforms will be implemented by our armed forces. Again, you know, it doesn't really sound like it's going in the right direction.
If you know who the head of the secret police is, they're not that secret.
Right, listen, can we talk about bankers a bit as well? Because
yeah, sure.
It has been dominating the headlines this week.
Launched my appeal.
I know.
Hopefully that'll make a difference.
You've got their backs, haven't you?
Well, I've slightly got their backs. You know, we'll try and send them what we can. I think we'll genuinely try and take donations and send them to the bank, see what happens.
Yeah.
If we send them a cheque, would they cash it? I'd love to know. Absolutely. If we had a whip round at a Sure Start Centre.
Not only would they cash it, it would take them several days to clear it.
Jimmy, you mentioned in your piece that the UK is becoming a giant tax haven, which was the subject of a brilliant article by George Monbiot in The Guardian this week, which people can get a link to on our website if they want to read it. It keeps me up at night, this kind of thing. Do any of you worry about that, or do you just kind of think it's always been...
I'm quite financially stupid. The problem is I read that article and I was following it all and I was furious. And then 2 minutes after I read it, I had no idea what I was so furious about. It had just unfocused rage.
It had the effect of someone treading on your toe.
Yes.
I think, John, knowing you, I think that may just be your personality.
I think, though, that fury is sort of... People's fury at the banks won't last forever, whether or not we get retribution from them. And I think that's why, when the tax was put up last week and the extra $800 million was raised from them, and then there were reports that the banks were livid, I don't believe they were livid. I think they were thinking they were getting off cheaply, and the Tories had said to them, you'd better pretend you're livid, because that's the way we'll lance the boil of public hatred, by thinking, that we made the bankers livid.
They're in charge, right?
They're rich.
But they're in charge.
They're in charge, and they're drunk.
It's a bit like us, really, except we're on telly.
Yeah.
Listen, time for break. We'll see you after it.
To 10 o'clock live. Now, I don't know if you've seen the famous Germans episode of Fawlty Towers where Basil gets a bang on the head and starts spouting outrageous xenophobic jabber. Well, it turns out that's basically the Richard Hammond story. Last week, he and the lovable Top Gear gang outraged many by saying this about Mexicans.
Why would you want a Mexican car? A Mexican car's just going to be a lazy, feckless, flatulent opulence. Leaning against a fence asleep, looking at a cactus with a blanket with a hole in the middle on as a coat. I'm sorry, but just imagine waking up and remembering you're Mexican.
Ha 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 ha! How droll! See, that's the problem with Richard Hammond. He doesn't know when to stop. If you're... In case you're watching, for future reference, I'd say the best place to stop is just before you overturn, hit the grass verge and carve a 30-metre ditch with your forehead like a rocket-powered human plough. Anyway, still never mind Top Gear. I'm more concerned the BBC is currently running a children's programme that explicitly portrays an ethnic minority as vermin. Take a look. Zuba, 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 then. Rasta, Mosan, Scratchy and Zuma, also known as the Easy Crew. Yes, Rasta Mouse is actually a charming new kids show about a reggae-loving mouse who solves mysteries. It's genuinely lovely and full of patois. Have a quick look at this.
Yo, guys.
Hey, me mouse.
You cool?
This boy is Irie, man.
Sweet.
See, it's genuinely sweet, and a perfect example of multicultural Britain in that it feels inherently British, but also exciting and new with a warm sense of humour. But there's always going to be some bigots who object, saying stuff like, well, I've got nothing against these Rasta mice personally, but you don't want them moving in next door. I mean, next thing you know, they're chasing your women. And come on, would you want your sister to marry one? A mouse? It's just unnatural. What about the kids? Can you imagine what the offspring would look like if a mouse fucked a human? Probably something like this. A horrible, horrible sort of hamster thing. And imagine waking up and going, oh no, I'm this. And now, David.